I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me. My soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away. My soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, shall come with shout of acclamation and lead me home. What joy shall fill my heart, and I shall bow with humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
You may be seated.
Amen, amen, church. What a timeless song. Thank you, Brother Mason, for leading that for us, and happy to have you lead worship again for us this Sunday. I have a couple announcements for you, and I want to welcome you those again to Noonday Baptist Church and those tuning in online as well, as we have a very exciting week happening here. In 6 days' time, we're going to have our fall festival, y'all, okay? We've been praying about this all year. This is something that is really a great opportunity for us just to step up as a church and to serve our community in a really mighty way. And so you see the sign on Canton. Thousands of drivers have seen that sign. And so we're expecting a lot of people to be on this campus in 6 days' time. So again, if you have not signed up to volunteer, there's still some slots open. Many of you have already answered the call, and so we want to thank you for that. But certainly we could use some more help as we get ready for that big day. And also, keep bringing in candy. Again, we've had a lot of candy brought in, but can't have too much candy. So keep bringing that in, and we'll be ready for next Saturday. In addition to that, next Sunday, we're going to have our next family fellowship lunch. It's going to be right after church here. And this time, we're going to have soups and sandwiches, and so we ask that you bring a side dish, dessert, etc. For that. And what we're doing differently this time around is we're actually going to have a trivia game happening as we are partaking in that lunch. And so, again, you know, if you're all about that trivia life, this is your time to shine, okay? So I hope to see you guys there next Sunday. In addition to that, we're going to have the culmination of a year-long project that we've been doing as a church for Operation Christmas Child. You guys have been bringing in different donations every single month. And in a couple weeks' time, we're actually going to have our packing party, okay? And so we're going to invite all of our Sunday Bible studies to be a part of that. It'll be during the 9:30 hour. And so, again, I invite you and your class to help with that. So we'll be right in here in the sanctuary. We'll have a little assembly line going on. So it should get done pretty quickly. But remember, this is more than a shoebox. It's more than a shoebox. It's an opportunity for kids all around the world to know about the gospel, know that God loves them. And we get to be a little bit a part of what God is doing globally. So, again, I want to invite you to be a part of that. Also, we have another Kel breakfast happening this week. And yeah, it's not up there, but we're actually making a big change. I'm actually asking you guys to be here at 5:30 a.m. Okay, give it up for that. Clap it up. Okay, 30 minutes extra to sleep in. There you go. That's my gift to you. All right. So 5:30. We're going to split up sort of our teams. There'll be a team cooking on the other side, other campus, and then we'll have a team sitting up in here where the team will be eating right here in the sanctuary. But last time we had 80 plus people show up. We expect those big numbers once again. Went super, super well. I want to thank everyone who's been a part of that this year. We've already had three breakfasts, and they've been phenomenal. And so if you've never been a part of this, just come check it out. I mean, it is pretty, pretty cool to see all these players in here because it's not, you know, we don't just feed them. You know, we have a time to share the word with them as well and just love on them. And so I invite you to be a part of that. If you're interested, you can email me. You see my email on the screen there. I'd love to have you a part of the team. So that's happening this Friday. And then finally, again, for all my parents here, middle school and high school parents, right after church today, we're going to meet in the pastor's reception for our parent luncheon. This is an opportunity just for us to catch up, talk about what's been happening at Rooted, and some very, very exciting plans for the rest of the year, and also going into 2023 as I officially reveal the location for our next mission trip. So even if you didn't RSVP, I still invite you to be a part of it. Come break bread with us because there's some really cool things happening with our students. So again, I want to thank you, church, for being here this morning. We're going to continue in our time of worship, and so I'm going to invite you to stand back up as we worship together.
People come together, strangers, neighbors, our blood is one. Children of generations, of every nation, kingdom come. Don't let your heart be troubled. Take courage, hold on, be strong, remember.
Heavenly Father, we're so blessed by you, and we're so grateful to be here in your house this morning, and we're so grateful for the air that we're breathing, and we're so grateful for those on our left and our right, and we pray this morning, God, that you would take all our distractions and all our fears and all the things that weigh us down this morning and take those things from us. We give them to you, God, because we want to focus on you and your word, and we want to celebrate you today, and we pray that your blessing be over all of us and this sanctuary and this service, and we pray that it be pleasing to you, and it's in your Son's holy name we pray. Amen.
God of glory, Thank you so much for being here. You may be seated. Thank you again, praise team, for leading us to the throne of the cross today. It's so beautiful when God's people can come together and join together for worship. It's so good to see you who are here this morning. Thank you for coming today. And if you're a guest with us, we want you to know that you are special to us. And we want you to feel right at home. Know that we're just like you. And the fact that we're striving to walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're just trying to walk with him step by step, day by day. And if you have any questions about Christian life, or you want to come to know him as your Lord and Savior, or you'd like to know more about our church, if you'll see us, myself will be at the back of the church, or you can grab somebody to sit next to you. We'll be glad to help you or talk to you about those things. But it's so good to see you in the Lord's house this morning. As we come together today, got some good-looking kids to my left today, and they're just anxious to come up on stage today. So I welcome up our children today for Kid Talk. Good morning, boys and girls. And a football game, that's what we call a reverse, when the pastor goes from one side of the stage to the other. I wanted to change it up today, and that's good to do. I wanted to sit by some more of our good-looking kids today that I normally don't get to sit by. Raise your hand if you know what the word grumbling means. It's a big word, to grumble. What is it, Ellis? What does it mean to grumble? Okay, man, you're deep in your theology. That's good. Yeah, the people at the Tower of Babel, they complained, right? What does that mean to grumble?
Not understand something.
Okay, partly. Yeah, partly. What does it mean to grumble, Zach or Zeke?
You're hungry.
Oh, stomach grumbling. All right. Pretty good. Pretty good. Pretty good. Mason, what does it mean to grumble?
Starving to death.
Okay, all right. Well, you guys have some really good answers, but really to what it means to grumble, it means to be dissatisfied with where you are or who you are, and usually the one that we're grumbling to is the Lord. And in Exodus chapter 16 and verse 13, the Bible tells us here that God had provided for the children of Israel, he provided this white substance that came out of the sky. Was called manna. It was like bread that you get to eat. And he also provided a dove for them in the evening to eat. So he provided bread and he provided meat for them to eat. And they were to be satisfied with that. But the scripture says that they grumbled. What are some things that we, or complained? What's some things that you find yourself complaining about every day being a child? Because I know it's got to be difficult to be a child. So tell me some things that you grumble about. Mr. Eli, what would you grumble about?
Doing jobs.
Oh, doing jobs. You got some tough parents, I hear. Yeah, doing jobs. What else would you grumble about?
I grumble about when my brother eats all the snacks.
Okay, all right, all right. Zeke, what do you grumble and complain about?
When I'm tired.
When you're tired, yeah. That's common, because if you don't get enough sleep or you daily routine, you get busy, don't complain. Ezra, what about you? What do you complain about?
That I have to do chores.
Yeah, I got to do chores. Yeah, those things can be difficult and those things can be tough, but it's part of growing up and it's part of your parents teaching you responsibility. But the bigger picture here is we must understand that God has blessed us. Look at the shoes that you have on. You got some nice shoes. Look at the shirts and the pants or dresses that you guys have. You look great. God has blessed you with those things. Raise your hand if you got to eat breakfast this morning. Anybody had breakfast today? All right. Yeah, most of us did. Raise your hand if you had a cup of coffee. Anybody have a cup of coffee today? I had a couple? Okay. That's good. God has blessed you, and we must recognize where our blessings come from the Lord. And therefore, we should not complain, but we should be grateful. Grateful. Grateful is saying, thank you, Lord, for the wonderful blessings you've given to me. Not taking them for granted, but thanking the one who has blessed us. So I want to encourage you today to not grumble, Don't complain. Let's be thankful. Be thankful for what God's given you. Be different than the children of Israel, because God provides. He promises He'll always provide. So let's be thankful, okay? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank You so much for these boys and girls, and thank You for teaching us today, Lord, how we should be grateful for all of our blessings. You bless the children of Israel with manna every day and quail, Lord, to eat. You gave them water to drink. They had all of their needs provided. You've provided for each one of us that are here today. And I pray that You would help us, Lord, to not only recognize where our blessings come from, but to be thankful to You, Lord, for all that You do. We love You, and we thank You for this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, boys and girls. We know as we extend that story today that as God has provided for each one of us here today, we must look up and be thankful for all that God has done for us. And I know that you are thankful who are here today. We look out as I see you today, and you're just a blessing to me by being here. And just as God caused the manna to come raining down of the sky, He's brought you here today to worship the Lord. How beautiful, how wonderful it is to be together as God's people. And as we've come together, we must recognize the biggest blessing that the Lord has given to us, and that is He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross to save us from our sins. By Jesus dying on the cross, we have redemption. We have salvation. We've been rescued from the chains of death and destruction and fear. We've been redeemed as God has transformed us from the inside out. And we've had a heart transformation. And our heart of stone has been changed to a heart of flesh. And now we can receive the truth of God whenever we open His Word. And His Word comes alive in our hearts and our lives, and forever will be changed. So today, if you're grateful as I am, as you're thankful, during this time of giving, I want to pray that you'll give back to the Lord out of gratitude. And just as God has rained blessings upon us, I pray that you will give back a portion of that blessing to the Lord, and that He'll continue to bless you as He loves a faithful giver and a cheerful giver. So let's give today generously out of the gratitude of our heart, and may God be praised. Let me pray for us today. Heavenly Father, we thank You so much, Lord, for the opportunity we have to be in Your presence and to be in Your house today. Thank You, Lord Jesus, for always providing for our needs. And Lord, I know that there are many here this morning, God, who are so grateful, Lord, for all that You've done. And I pray that we would reflect that gratefulness, Lord, through our giving. Lord, we have the opportunity right now to reach into our pockets and give back some of that manna which You have freely bestowed upon us. And Lord, I pray that we would do just that, not holding back, but to give generously, Lord, as You've given to us. We thank You so much, Lord, for how You love us in spite of our sin. And Lord, we just want to worship You. We just want to praise You. We thank You so much for Your mercy, Your grace, Your forgiveness. And Lord, as we pour out our offerings upon You today, I pray that they'd be pleasing Your sight. May You continue to bless this service. And Lord, may You use this offering to go around the world so that others will know You. And I pray, Lord, that You would richly bless the giver today, both monetarily and spiritually. And we give You all the praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you have your Bibles today, I want to encourage you to turn to the book of Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, as we're going to be looking at verses 16 and following. And if you're physically able, if you'll stand in honor of God's word here together. The Bible says, "And when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you." Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for your precious word. I ask today, God, that as you are moving in our midst, as you are speaking to hearts and as you're opening up minds today to hear your perfect word, I ask, Lord, today that you would minister to each one who are here today. Lord, not only would you feed them with your word, but I pray, God, that you would challenge them today, Lord, to grow in their walk with you, to become more like you. And I ask, Lord, today that you would use me as an imperfect vessel to preach forth your perfect truth. And Lord, may you be praised in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much. You may be seated. Today I'd like to talk to you about a subject that many are not familiar with in the Baptist church. We like to eat our fried Southern Baptist chicken. We like to eat our baked ham. We like to eat our sweet potatoes for some of you. We like to eat our apple pie. We like to have our banana pudding. We like to eat all types of good types of food. And we live in a country that's been so blessed with so many types of foods that we all have our favorites. But today I want to talk to you about a subject that challenges the subject matter of eating, and that is on the opposite end, I want to talk to you about fasting. God asks and he expects a believer, as they mature in their walk with God, I believe, to have times in their life to fast. And what is fasting? Fasting, my friends, is doing without a certain food or something that's very valuable to you in order to pursue spiritual purposes, in order to further your walk with God. I want to ask you this morning, have you ever fasted before? Is that part of your life? Have you ever had the opportunity where you have set aside something that's valuable to you in order to give that time to the Lord in prayer and in reading his word instead of indulging in food? If you haven't, I want to challenge you to do so. Again, as your senior pastor, I would never ask you to do something that I'm not willing to do myself. And when we fast, as I shared this morning, you're not supposed to go, "Hey, yo, you know what? I'm fasting. Everybody take a look at me. Put the spotlight on me. Know that I am fasting today. Woohoo! I'm fasting. Everybody look at me." You're not supposed to draw attention to yourself when you fast. It's a private matter. But at the same time, as you privately fast before the Lord, it's your time that you pray to the Lord and say, "God, what would you have me give up so that I can spend that time with you?" I'm right now fasting. I'm not publicly trying to promote that, but because I'm your pastor and I'm trying to encourage you to do something, again, I'm trying to encourage you so that you're not doing something that I'm not willing to do myself. I'm not going to be a hypocrite before you and say, "Hey, I want you to do this," when I'm not willing to do it myself. It's a partial fast. There's several types of fasts that you can do. One's a full fast where you do without food and you do without water for an extended period of time. There's partial fast, which is what I'm at right now. I'm doing without sweets. Yes. I'm doing without sweets, and it's hard because I like my sweets. I really do. God's really challenged me. We had the youth over last night, which we really enjoy having them over for a time of fellowship. And God just put it upon my plate that I was in charge of the bonfire that we had there on Sable Trace Cove. And I had all my neighbors there out there, like, you know, wanting to call the fire department because we normally don't have a fire at our house. But we had a controlled bonfire, and it was my responsibility to put together the kids' s'mores. We had s'mores at our house. And so as they had their little fire sticks, they put their little marshmallows on the end of the stick and put it in the fire. And once the marshmallow got ooey and gooey, we took it off. And it was my job to take the 2 graham crackers and slide that beautiful golden marshmallow off of that fire stick, slap 2 golden graham crackers together and put that sliver of chocolate on the middle of it and smash it together and reluctantly give it back to that youth so that they could eat it. Can I get a witness on that? Have you ever struggled with anything in your life like I've struggled with giving that s'more back to our youth? Because I'm fasting. I'm doing away with sweets. And I, at that point and at that time, I'm supposed to be in prayer, and I was in prayer. I wasn't in the Word at the time because I was dealing with the kids, but it's a time of longing for the Lord instead of longing for food. And for me, it's doing without sweets. And so I have now, because of fasting, the benefit is that it builds up a sensitivity within your heart and your life that you long for God that you didn't have before. And we're going to see today that there's great power, there's great strength, there's great motivation when you fast. And I want to encourage you today, if you've never fasted before, that you begin to do so. And pray about it before you do. For some of us, you say, well, I can't do without food because I've got medical challenges in my life. I understand that. There's other things that you can do without. Coffee. Oh, my goodness, can I get a witness on that? So many folks have drink coffee. You can do without coffee for a day. You can. You can do without it for 2 days. There's a Daniel fast, like Daniel in the book of Daniel chapter 6. He was one who did without meat and bread and just ate vegetables and drank water for 21 days. And because of that, God blessed him with great wisdom so that he was able to be a blessing to those around him. That's a good fast. Some of us can do without television, or if we're a young person, we can do without video games for a day or a week, or let's go 21 days. I challenge you to do it. And what's the benefit of that? Your relationship to God was going to prosper. God's going to create within you a hunger and a desire for the Lord Jesus that you didn't have before. And you must understand that God knows more about what you need than you do. God knows what you need more than you do. I, as the Lord led in my life, He was desiring for me to do this. And why? Because I find in my own personal life, as I read theology books all the time, as I strive to listen to good speakers, to be filled in my own personal life, to fill my bucket so that I can share with others spiritually, that I find even through all of these experiences that I find that I can get plateaued in my spiritual walk. I bet you also can find that you get plateaued in your spiritual walk and you need God's help. And in order for that to happen, we need to fast. I find as well that there's times that I get a dullness in my hunger and a desire for the Lord when I get in the flesh and I desire and long for the things of the world more than I long for the things of God. And it's then that time that I, as the Lord speaks to me, I need to fast. I need to get before the Lord. I need to make sure that He's top priority in my life. I don't know if you've ever felt that way before, but understand there's a danger. And did you know that the busyness of life can bring you to the point of losing your freshness? That you can lose your enthusiasm, and you can lose your sensitivity to the Lord Jesus Christ. You can do it when we are dining on the things of this world more than we are dining in God's Word and in our time of prayer. We can lose our sensitivity to God. You don't lose your salvation, but you can lose your sensitivity to the things of God. I just want to ask you a question today. Anybody here today feeling dull or numb or insensitive to the things of God? Anybody here today been diving in on the spiritual junk food of this world, been watching, all you've been doing, watching TV, or video games, or been watching the news, and been discouraged and down and down out? You've been all over this election thing, and it's just, just contaminated your mind to the point where you're insensitive to the things of God. I want to encourage you today, if you say yes to one of those questions, you need to fast before the Lord. You'll benefit from it. What's the big idea today? The big idea for our message today is this, that God expects us to make fasting a part of our lives as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the big idea. The big idea is that fasting is abstaining from food or something personally valuable and replacing that with quality time with the Lord Jesus. When can that be? You can fast anytime. You can do it from sunup to sundown. Maybe it's just for one meal that you start. You say, well, I'm just going to do without lunch today. That's a big challenge for us, but you can do it, and God would have you to do it. The big challenge today as well is that when we fast, we're needing God's direction. We're needing God's wisdom. We're needing God's help, and we recognize that, saying, God, will you please help me in this area of my life? I found as well that when you fast, that God can break spiritual bondage in your life. Maybe you're addicted to something. Maybe it's, something in this world, whether it be alcohol, or maybe it may be food. Maybe it's pornography. Maybe it's wealth and gambling. Maybe it's, anger. I don't know what it is that you're dealing with, but God can break you from these things if you will fast. And spiritual nourishment will come. Refreshment will come. I found personal revival comes for me as I fast before the Lord. We're going to look today at the passage of Scripture and see what God says. Looking back at verse 16, the Bible says, and when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites. The word there, gloomy, it means to draw attention to yourself or to be noticed because you are letting everyone else know what you're doing. But we must understand that God is telling us here, first of all, that fasting with the wrong motives does not please the Lord. Fasting with the wrong motives does not please the Lord. The Pharisees were doing just that. They turned their frown upside down. They were trying to look all depressed, and they were trying to draw attention to themselves as they communicated, saying, "Hey, I'm fasting from sunup to sundown," and drawing attention to themselves instead of doing what God had them or wanted them to do. And they were fasting with the wrong motives. What are the wrong motives? Well, publicly, when we are going around announcing to the world that we're fasting, that's wrong. What's another wrong motive? Walking around discouraged and discontent, trying to get the attention of others. Again, publicly communicating the wrong things. That's what they were doing at this time. And when they were doing so, it doesn't please the Lord. Jesus says here, he says, when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites. They disfigured their faces. They had frowns. They were acting and saying, woe is me, poor is me, because I'm fasting before the Lord. Jesus says there, truly I say to you, they have received their reward. Leads me to my second point, that is that fasting with the wrong motives gains the accolades of people rather than from God. You gain the accolades of people rather than from God. It was for example, my son Eli, after our youth event last night, he was tired and he was down and he was upset because he didn't get any pizza that night. Because, when you throw pizza out before youth, it's like throwing meat into a pool of piranha. I mean, it's like those kids ate that pizza up in no time. And he came to me and he had a big fat lower lip. He's like, Dad, I didn't get any pizza. And it's 9:30. I said, well, what are we going to do, son? And he's like, you were supposed to eat. Well, I didn't eat anything. And he had a gloomy look, and he was down. He was not nice to talk to for the moment. And so we had to feed that boy so that he would change his countenance. But he was drawing attention to himself because he wanted his dad to feel sorry for him and look with those puppy dog eyes and that big lower lip so that I would get him some food. And it worked. And sure enough, I gave him some food and he was fine and happy and his countenance changed. But this is what the Pharisees were doing. But they were doing it to the point of saying they wanted some accolade. They wanted to be noticed. They wanted attention to be drawn away from the Lord Jesus and be drawn to them. And it was dangerous and it wasn't right. And it wasn't the thing that God would say would be pleasing to him. Because when we strive to get the applause of people, as the Pharisees were doing, it's incorrect. They as well were like you and I, where we tend to get our trophies for our talents and say, oh, look at me. I'm drawing attention to myself. I can do this on my own. And that's an incorrect mindset, as the Pharisees had this in their mind. They also were trying to get admiration from others, as I shared, which isn't right. Well, here's a question for us today. Why should we work for worldly praise when, in fact, we can have so much more in heaven? Why would we want worldly praise when we can get so much more with the Lord? And what I mean is that when we fast, let's do it privately. When we fast, let's do it quietly. When we fast, let's do it reverently. When we fast, let's do it obediently. And as we do so, watch God work. I like Franklin Jensen in his book, Fasting. He states there that when he fasts, God moves. That when he fasts, he sees God in action. And that personally, he does a divine work in his life like none other. He says, quote, that the gates of heaven are open wide and that the gates of hell are closed shut immediately when he fasts. That's encouraging for me to want to fast because I want God to do a work in my life. But we have to ask ourselves the question, where is our treasure? Remember, as Matthew 6:21 says, that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So let me ask you this question. Do you love God more than you love food? Do you love God more than you love video games? Do you love God more than you love your job or your career? Do you love God more than you love your car or your money or your success? Do you love God more than anything? Again, Jesus says, where our treasure is, there our heart will be also. And if we are fasting before the Lord, saying, God, I recognize that you're most important, that you are supreme in my life, that I don't care what food comes before me, I'm going to put that aside when we're fasting, and I'm going to focus that time on you. That means we open God's Word, and we begin to read, and we begin to search. Like a diver is looking for that lost fish, that rare fish picture, or that seashell, or that treasure. Just like a diver would swim in the tropics to find that treasure, that's how we are to be in our time of fasting. We're longing and looking for God to do a work in our life as we read His Word, as we pray, and just as we desire and long for food. We long and desire for God and for Him to do a spiritual work in my life more than we love these things. Do you love God that much? I want to encourage you to begin to fast today because fasting brings benefits spiritually in our life. So remember what Jesus says in the book of Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. He says, whatever you do, that we are to work heartily for the Lord, as not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance for your reward, as a real reward. Meaning as we work for the Lord, as we fast for the Lord, as we strive for the Lord, that we will be rewarded when we fast. And it's important to do just that. I like what Job 23 tells us, that he loved and longed for God so much after his time of hardship and difficulty. In Job 23:10, he says, I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than I have necessary food. I have longed and looked for God more, and I have found benefit because I long for him more than anything. I like what Psalms 34:8 says, taste and see that the Lord is good. When you fast and when you spend that time alone with God and when you're longing for Him, I'm going to tell you, as I have learned from personal experience, you'll taste and see that God is good when you long for Him and you search for Him. And you will find Him there because He's there faithfully. Thirdly, remember this, that fasting with the right motives receives the approval of God. Fasting with the right motives receives the approval of God. What are the right motives? We see that back in the scripture here in verse 17. It says, but when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. He will reward you. We see here the key to fasting. What is key is that you find your secret place. The secret place where you are alone with the Lord and the Lord is with you. As I was sharing with my class this morning, God desires for you and I to have an intimate relationship with Him. He desires to walk with you like Adam and Eve walked in the Garden of Eden. And just as God provided for them, He wants to provide for you. And just as God took care of their needs, He wants to take care of your needs. But more than that, God desires to walk with you in an intimate relationship that is as a father and a child. And He wants to be close to you. It reminds me just yesterday, I'm so excited, in the fact that I counseled a couple that's getting married in just 2 weeks. They're in love. And the reason I know that they're in love is because when they came for their final session, just yesterday, I put 2 chairs out in my office, and they sat in one. Y'all with me? Anybody else in love like that? I mean, I said, no. You got to sit in 2 chairs, not 1 chair, but 2 chairs. They're not living together, but they're anxious about getting married. 2 weeks is all I got, but I had to separate them because they're in love. And they just laughed at me like, sorry, Pastor Mark, because they're in love. And then as I separated them, they had their hands together like this. I mean, death grip hold, because they're in love. And they were afraid that I was going to separate them even more. So they got this death grip on. And they're just, you know, go ahead, Pastor Mark, tell us what you need to tell us for our third session. And then we're going to be gone. They were in love to the point as they bumped to one another. And at one another, they laughed, and when we were talking, they would joke, and they just kept staring at one another. In fact, they had trouble focusing in on me because they're staring at one another because they're so in love. They've never been married before, 35 years of age, and they're so excited about what's coming because they're going to get married. Y'all's relationship like that to the Lord, is it is that good? Is your relationship to God that to that point that when you open your Bible with the Lord, that your heart just begins to overflow as the Holy Spirit begins to work and the tears begin to come down your face and God begins to speak in your life and you just don't want to close the Word and you just don't want to stop praying because it is just so good? Anybody have that relationship with the Lord today? I'm telling you, when you fast, there is a longing, there is a desire, there's a new passion, there's personal revival, there's renewal, there's some good things that happen when you begin to fast before the Lord. And I want to encourage you, if you've never fasted before, start today. Start today. And may it be just 1 hour fast, maybe it's a 4 hour fast, but if you will begin to do that, God's going to do a transformational work in your life. I want to encourage you to do that. Because fourthly, the reward for fasting is fellowshipping with God in the secret place of our hearts. What is that? Psalms 32:7 says, you are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You saturate me with shouts of deliverance. This is the Lord now. As David pointed out that when he had a time of fasting in his life, that God did a new work for in his life. We are to, as we fast, we're to hunger more for his presence than we do our longing for this life. Fasting prepares us for the way for God to give us a fresh revelation, for fresh vision, for fresh purpose in our life. As I pray for you so many times, congregation, I pray for God to put new wind in your sails. As you are a mighty ship, as God leads, there are times in our life when we get stagnant and we need fresh wind in our lives. We need fresh, rejuvenating wind that only God can provide. And that comes when we fast, when we do without in order to be sensitive to the things of God. Because when you do without something that makes you comfortable or makes you feel good in the flesh, and you've replaced that with time with the Lord, I'm telling you, great things take place. And most importantly, personal revival will take place. And I pray for that for you. And although a secret place can refer, as we see here, a secret place can refer to a physical location, it most often connotes a state of soul in his relationship with the Lord. Meaning here is that the secret place that I'm talking about, as many of us, when we were growing up, we had a place where we went and hid to get away from others, right? As the only boy in my family, I had two sisters, one on both sides. My oldest sister, as we lived in the country and I grew up on a farm, my oldest sister, when I was at the age of eight, she shoved my face in a pile of cow manure, and I still haven't forgot that. If you're watching, Suzanne, I haven't forgot that. She made me literally eat cow manure because she was stronger than me as my older sister. I had a younger sister as well who would take my toys out of my room as a boy, and especially I had a favorite Tonka truck that you could change the tires on it. It had this little twisty tire removal thing, and you could replace it with it, and I just love that truck. Well, that rotten sister of mine, she left my Tonka truck outside in the rain, and she hid it from me, and it was over a month before I even figured out where it was, and by the time I got it back, it was all rusty. And I'm going to tell you what, Sonia, I was really upset about that, as she knows even today. The point I'm saying is that I was tortured growing up. Y'all, please feel sorry for me as the middle child today. And so my grandfather, who lived next door, he built for me a tree house that was elevated up 5.5 feet off the ground, that was next to four nestled pines Palatka, Florida, and I would go there many times just to get away from my evil sisters. I didn't do anything wrong to them. No, I'm just kidding, I did. But there was a time, it was my secret place. But what the Bible tells us here is that God desires to be in your secret place, and the secret place is in your heart. The secret place where God wants to communicate with you and deal with your struggles of being in sin or discouragement or discontentment or hardship or addiction or whatever the case may be. God wants to get into the secret places of your heart to communicate with you and you to communicate with Him. And there He wants to be able to be like that newlywed couple that just wants to sit together and talk with you and you talk with Him. And it just be a wonderful time that just seems to never end. And it can happen for you if you'll put away those yellow marshmallow Twinkies or that dinner that you were focused on so much for that you just long to eat. Or maybe it's coffee or maybe it's video games. But if you will put those things aside and give that time to the Lord, you will find the Lord in your secret place. Secret place, as you open up your heart, Jesus says there, ask and it will be given, seek and you'll find, knock and the door shall be open. Because you see, the handle of the door of your heart, it's not on the outside for Jesus to open the door, it's on the inside. You have to open the door for Jesus to come in. And there Jesus says that I will dine with you and you with me, and we will be able to have much fellowship in the book of Revelation. He tells us that there. So fasting prepares us for this, and God desires to do that for you in your life if you will give it that time over to the Lord. Why are we to do that? Well, because the Psalms 139:15 says that my frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret. When you open the secret place of your heart, God will see your struggles. He's going to help you with your needs. Here it speaks of the hidden world of a mother's womb as a child develops. In other words, when you open your heart to the Lord, when God comes to dwell within you, as you ask Him into your heart to be your Lord and Savior, there a special relationship is developed. There's a communication that takes place. There is a transformation that takes place. There is a beautiful bond that only you and God have as a child, as a father. And as you grow in your walk with God, it gets bigger and it gets better. It gets stronger and it gets more able to go against the fire darts of the devil, and you're able to be able to be that strong Christian that God wants you to be. That's the secret place. So, in other words, when we get into the secret place of the Lord, we can experience the presence of God as we enter that secret place. And there, Psalms 27:5 says, He will be to me a shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of His tent. He will lift me high upon a rock. He is that rock, and He wants to do that work in your life today. So, as we understand here, David points in Psalms 42 that he's not referring to an actual tabernacle or tent in which we will hide from physical enemies, but he is speaking of the state of peace that God gives to us when we open up our heart and God comes into that place with us. You know, as a boy growing up in my treehouse, the only person that was able to come into my treehouse with me was my golden retriever named Lassie. She was the only one that could come into my treehouse. And in my treehouse there was a mattress where we would sit and hang out. We had a set of shelves where I had Nature Valley granola bars so that we could survive. I had a case of Gatorade that my mother gave to me. And so my sisters were not able to drink of that. My sisters were not able to eat of my granola bars or drink my Gatorade. It was for me and for me alone. Those were my treasures. And I could pet my dog and I could tell my problems to my dog. And my dog, Lassie, just looked there and smiled at me and loved me. It was my secret place. Well, I'm going to tell you what. When you open your heart to the Lord and you spend time in fasting with God, there's a sensitivity that is built up for the things of God that you don't have before you fast. There's an awareness that comes that God gives to you when you fast that before you do not have. There's a hunger that is developed for the things of God that before you fast, you don't have. But once God does that work in your life, I'm telling you, you hunger for Him more than anything. And there is a perceptivity and sensitivity that when God speaks to you, when you have that time of fast, you'll hear that still small voice. You'll recognize the voice of God, and you will answer, and you will long for it, and you will follow it. You will run after it because you know how sweet it can be. God wants to do that work in your life today. My friends, He wants to do that work in your life today because God is spirit and His glory is beyond our ability to perceive. And we must meet with Him in the secret places of the heart in order to commune with Him. God wants to commune with you today if you'll let Him, because we understand that God wants to do supernatural works in your life, but you've got to be willing to make the sacrifice. In conclusion today, as a challenge, in the book of Joel chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, we understand there that the people were so poor and in such famine that they could not even bring an offering before the Lord. But God told them there, blow the trumpet in Zion. And as you blow that trumpet, I want you to secretly fast before the Lord and come together as a solemn assembly. So they fasted, they prayed, they fasted, and they prayed, and they fasted, and they prayed. And as they did so, after the fast, the Bible says there that the threshing floor of wheat, which before had no wheat, was now filled with wheat as well. We know that the oil vats that were empty were now overflowing with oil. We know as well that they who had no food now suddenly had plenty to eat and were full and were filled, which otherwise they were having hunger groans and pains. So the Lord also brought great financial blessing to the people who fasted and prayed. Supernatural works began to take place in their life as God began to fast, or as they began to fast to the Lord and as they prayed. And God wants to do that for you. Remember as well, Jesus himself would not ask of you or me to do something that we that he wouldn't do himself. Before Jesus was to go into the Garden of Gethsemane, and before he was to have the sins of the world put upon himself, the Bible says that Jesus went into the wilderness there, and he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And after he did that, we know that Satan appeared to him at the very end of his fast. And it's not by secret, because Jesus would be hungry at that time. And Satan himself provided bread for him and said, you know, tell me the secrets of the world is my translation. You just go ahead and tell me all these things, and then I'll give you bread. I'll turn these, you know, you can turn these rocks into bread, and there you can be satisfied. And as Jesus was tempted, he, of course, did not listen to the devil. He said, get behind me, Satan. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day you've given to us. We thank you, Lord, for teaching us today about the benefits of fasting. Lord, forgive us when we are fearful in our fasting, as we all, Lord, do not practice fasting on a daily basis. Through your word, Lord, you've challenged us today to be people who fast. Lord, because we see that supernatural blessings and spiritual growth comes from being those that fast and do without some of the pleasures of this world. Lord, you've blessed us with so much in this world, so many things that we dine on, so many things that we love and desire. Lord, I pray today for each person gathered here today, as I know that there are some here who've become insensitive to the things of God. They become numb to you speaking to them because they're just so satisfied with the things of this world. And Lord, through your word today, you have reminded them. There's been an awakening spiritually, God, that we've been dining on the things of the world more than we should be, and we've been dining on the things of the world when we need to be dining on your word, and we need to be spending time in prayer. We need to be having this time of allowing you to be in our secret place, in our heart, to do supernatural works. Lord, there's some here today that need to come to the altar today, as you've challenged them about fasting, that they need to come and as you want them to fast in their life, and they just need to make that spiritual commitment that they're going to give up coffee, or they're going to give up lunch, or they're going to give up snack time, or they're going to give up video games, just so that you will do a new spiritual work in their life. There's some here who spiritually plateaued, and you want to begin to break that bond in their life and do something new. Lord, we commit this time to you together as we have this invitation. Lord, may you stir our hearts. And if we are here today that we need to draw closer to you, to grow in our walk with you, may you move in our hearts. May we come, may we respond. Maybe we're here today and we've never trusted Christ as our Lord and Savior, and they'd like to know how. God, move on their hearts this morning as well. Have your way with this invitation, Lord. Speak to us now in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to be here at the front, and if you're here this morning, you don't know Christ as your Savior, you come. Maybe you're here this morning and you're needing a spiritual breakthrough, and God has put on your heart today, you need to begin to fast. Maybe you're facing a challenge in your life and you need answers. God's saying, you need to fast. Maybe you're here today and you are addicted to something. It's got a stronghold in your life. God wants to set you free. You need to fast. Maybe you're here this morning and you need spiritual revival, personal revival in your life. You need to fast. You need to come. Let God do that supernatural work in your life so that you can grow, so that you can have that spiritual revitalization. People can see the change in your life and that you can be that mighty witness he's called you to be. Whatever God's called you to do this morning, you come as we have this time of invitation. Let's stand together.
The splendor of the King
clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great
service today. I know you've challenged many here today to do without something of this world so that we can have a better understanding of you, a greater relationship to you, a stronger relationship to you. So Lord, as we go from this place today, I pray, Lord, that we would not rest until, Lord, we take that challenge, that spiritual challenge, and fast before you. And Lord, I pray that as we take those steps, you will show up and show off in our life like never before. Lord, we look forward to the results next week when we come back of how you've worked in our life, how you've moved, how you've spoken. Lord, I just ask now that as we go and as we accept that challenge, Lord, that you would begin right now to speak to our hearts. And as we go today, I pray that you'd give us traveling mercies. Pray that you would keep your mighty hand upon us. Continue, God, to lead us, guide us, and direct us. Most importantly, may you grow us as we grow together as the body of Christ, as Noonday Baptist Church. Thank you so much for this wonderful time of worship as we serve a wonderful and awesome God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.